Good evening and welcome to In the European Night, Will the Union Survive? Which is a lecture by Italian philosopher Franco Bifo Berardi. My name is Vivian Schmidt. I'm the Jean Monnet Professor of European Integration and Director of the Center for the Study of Europe here at Boston University in the Pardee School. Our event this evening is taking place as part of a longer-term project entitled EU Futures, the aim of which is to explore the emerging future in Europe. It is the second of what we hope will be seven lectures in a series called Interferences on the prospects of democratic politics in Europe in the aftermath of the recent, and in some cases ongoing, financial crisis. The project is funded by Getting to Know Europe grant, which is a grant to the Center for the Study of Europe from the European Commission delegation in Washington, D.C. We're naturally grateful to the delegation for their support for our initiative. Tonight's lecture is moderated by Nicholas Knuff, Associate Professor of Cinema and Media Studies at Wellesley College. Nicholas is a media scholar and artist researching noise, interferences, sound, information, and affect in media of the 20th and 21st centuries. He's the author of a new book, How Noise Matters to Finance, a fascinating study of how noise, sonic information or otherwise, affects the way financial markets function. Before I turn the floor over to Nicholas, who will introduce Franco Berardi for us, I'd like to take a minute to ask you to silence your mobile devices. I'd also like to remind you that the event is being recorded, so please wait for the microphone if you would like to ask a question. The event will be followed by a reception and book signing to which you're all cordially invited. So I leave it to you, Nicholas. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that introduction. And it is my honor and privilege to be here tonight and share the stage and introduce Franco Bifo Berardi, one of the most thought-provoking theorists and practitioners of media and political thought today. I teach at Wellesley in the Cinema and Media Studies program and an assistant professor there. And so I came to Berardi's work through his experiments and writings about media. When I was beginning my dissertation research and writing an article on the activities of a group called Hackatectura from Spain, they were trying to create one of the first wireless data transmissions across the Straits of Gibraltar between Spain and Morocco. I was thinking of how to theorize this work and, of course, turn to Deleuze and Guattari. And while reading Guattari's work, I came across the descriptions and histories of this project called Radio Alice, which Berardi was involved with very extensively in Bologna in the late 1970s. And so what drew me most prominently to Berardi's work in Radio Alice in particular was the attention to the power of what we could call the boundaries or limits of language, of signs, of semiotics. When Felix Guattari was writing about Radio Alice, he wrote, quote, "On Italian free radio, it often happens that very serious debates are directly interrupted by violently contradictory, humorous, or even poetical delirious interventions," end quote. The violent shutdown of Radio Alice and the generalized crackdown on protest movements in Italy at the time did not stop Berardi from continuing his work in media, as he did with the telestreet phenomenon of micro television stations that broadcast to small localized regions, begun in Bologna, as well as online projects such as recombinant.org. So I see Berardi's more recent writings as those of a nuanced, complex, and timely thinker who is always informed by the machinations of media practice. For my own writings and artistic projects, I've drawn to Berardi's ideas of how noise, impurity, the limits, the boundaries, the poetic, desire, can disrupt semiocapitalism and the financialization of language. In The Uprising on Poetry and Finance, Berardi writes of the need for paresia, or fearless speech, to counter contemporary cynicism, and he explores in that book how poetry and art might just be able to be used against capitalism, and I would argue act as forms of paresia as well. I just want to quote a bit from this book, The Uprising, that I think hopefully we can turn to a little bit during the discussion today, namely the power of the ways in which poetry and art and media can counter some of the microfascisms and semi-capitalism more generally. He writes, quote, "In the current conditions of capitalist competition, acceleration is the trigger for panic, and panic is the premise to depression. Singularity is forgotten, erased, and canceled in the erotic domain of semi-capitalism. The singularity of the voice and the singularity of words are subjected to the homogenization of exchange and valorization," end quote. But he writes a bit later that poetry, quote, "is the singular vibration of the voice. This vibration can create resonances, and resonances can produce common space," end quote. I thus see Berardi as a manifestly hopeful thinker and activist, someone for whom the power of poetry, of art, of desire, has the potential to disrupt microfascisms and semi-capital alike. Berardi's title today is In the European Night, Will the Union Survive? Please join me in welcoming Franco Bifo Berardi.
Thank you, Nick. And I will speak not more than 45 minutes, possibly less. And yes. Sometimes in life and in history too, we have to think with two different brains, if I may say so. One has to be the realistic brain, the brain that is focused on the likely future, the probable future. The other brain is the brain that is dedicated to the imagination of the possible. And to distinguish these two different levels is important at the theoretical level and also at the existential level in order to avoid despair, depression sometimes. And particularly it's important because we should not mistake reality and the probability, the probable future, with the whole spectrum of possibility. The possible is much more wide than the probable. I would say that actually future does not exist. And we should replace the concept of future with the concept of futurability. Different layers of possibilities. I say that in this moment because if we realistically look at the next decade, we risk to be lost, to get lost, to have the impression that nothing can be done. Actually some of the trends, of the tendencies that are inscribed in the present situation of the world, and particularly of Europe, seem to be unstoppable, in a sense. And the possibility of reverting the present condition, of escaping the present condition, has to be found starting from the consciousness that what is happening, what is probably going to happen tomorrow is not the entire spectrum of the possibility. I will try now to speak about the probability, what we see. But at the end, I will try to look at this fissure, at this discrepancy. Not exactly a contradiction, much more an asymmetry that gives us the possibility of imagining something that is apparently totally realistic. Nothing to do with the utopia. I don't like the word utopia. It's a sort of trap. I prefer to think of possibilities inscribed in the present that we are unable to see at the present. Stop with the philosophy. Let's start to talk about the present. Just 2 days ago, the former president of the European Commission, whose name is Romano Prodi, said the following words, quote, "I am not resigned, but I am obliged to certify a progressive weakening of the European Union, not only because of the Brexit, but because of the lack of any common sentiment and of any common policy." Prodi said this at the University of Pisa 2 days ago. And simultaneously, more or less in the same hour, in the city of Calais, François Hollande, the president of the French Republic, said, "We are going to totally dismantle the jungle. We don't want that France may become a territory of refugees." When I read this word, I have been a refugee in France for 2 years. And I remember that when I was there, my friends were refugees from the fascist Spain, from many countries of Africa, of South America, and so on. So reading those words of the irresponsible and, frankly speaking, ignorant president of the French Republic gave me a sort of bad effect. In the same day, 2 days ago, in a lovely country called Switzerland, there was a referendum. And the referendum was about the workers, the migrant workers coming from Italy. Not exactly from Italy, particularly from Lombardia, a northern region which is led by a racist party called Northern League. Well, as you know, every north is the south of somebody else. The Swiss decided that the Lombardi cannot come to work in Switzerland. And guess what was the slogan of the right wing fighting against the Italian workers? Switzerland first, of course. Everybody is first, but this starts to become a problem. Well, three events, three significant events in the same day. I would say that three clues are an evidence. The evidence that dark has fallen in Europe. Then I came to Boston 2 days ago, and yesterday night I had the opportunity to watch TV and listening to. So I decided that dark is coming in many places of the world. Let's try to understand what's happening in Europe, because the evidence is that the European Union is a non-existing thing. I mean, after the massive wave of migration from Northern Africa and the Middle East, you know that the reaction of some of the European countries, namely Hungary, Poland, and some other Eastern countries of Europe, that reaction has been totally breaking the very idea of union. Italy and Greece are overwhelmed by the migration wave, but the Hungarian and the Polish don't want to deal with the problem. Well, don't forget that 2 million Polish are working as migrants in the United Kingdom, in the Midlands particularly. And as you know, the British have decided that they are no more union. Oh, I understand. And they are no more European. So all of a sudden, Polish people are saying no to the Syrians, and the Midlanders of the United Kingdom are demonstrating in the streets against the Polish workers, because what are you doing here? This is no more Europe, so go back to Poland. This is enough, I think, to understand why we can say that the European Union is a dead man walking, is a sort of zombie that is unable to decide about the most important things. Some important things are decided. For instance, remember in July 2015, 5 July 2015, the Greek people go to vote for a referendum about yes or not accepting the diktat of the Troika. 62% of the Greek voters said no, we cannot accept a more devastation of our economy, of our society, of our daily life. We cannot accept the humiliation of imposed by the Troika. What has happened next, the following days? 5 days after, Tsipras is obliged to go to Bruxelles to take out his jacket. He threw that jacket on the table of the discussion. He said, do you want also this? The Greek government has been obliged to accept the humiliation and the economic devastation that in the polls they had rejected. In that case, the union has been working. Matteo Renzi, the Italian young premier who these days is screaming that he needs, Italy needs more flexibility, 1 year ago was not so flexible about the Greeks. He was part of the unified European decision of not respecting the decision of the majority of the Greeks. So when I say the European Union does not exist, I must say something more. The European Union does not exist except when it comes to paying the debt, except when it comes to rescue the banks, the bank system. That is the situation. But let's try, how have we got at this point? What has happened before? I don't want to remount to 60 years ago. I don't want to remount to the Maastricht Treaty. Just I want to make a fast remind about the recent transformation of the Union. I start from the year 2005. In the year 2005, a constitutional transformation has been proposed, which was essentially aimed to the so-called liberalization of the labor market. Liberalization of the labor market means that the average salary of a Polish worker is 500 euros, the average salary of a French worker is 1500 euros, a liberalization of the job of the labor market would have implied a general reduction of the salary in Europe, which is happening. I mean, we can say that in the last 20 years, my salary, I speak about myself, my salary has been more or less halved. It has been halved in the passage from the Italian lira to the euro. My salary was 2 million lire at the end of the 90s, and the year after it has become 1,000 euros, because officially 1 euro equals 2,000 lire. Actually, 1,000 euros buys as much as 1 million lire, not 2 million. So actually, for the southern countries of Europe, the shift from national currency to the European currency has translated into a general reduction of the average salary. This is not true for the German workers, for instance, but it's certainly true for the Spanish, the Greeks, the Italians, the French too. What happens in 2005? When this constitutional transformation is proposed in France and Holland, many social organizations propose a referendum against this transformation. At that point, the refusal of the financial aggression against the salary of the people, this referendum, this refusal, has been backed by the National Front in France and has been not backed by the left. By the left, I mean by the Socialist Party, by Daniel Cohn-Bendit, and also by Tony Negri. Tony Negri and Danny Cohn-Bendit said, and I must confess that I agreed with them. We said, no, if we say no to this constitutional transformation, we are breaking the Union. We are provoking an effect of renationalization of the politics of France, of Holland, then of all the other countries. It has been probably the most serious mistake of my personal political life. I was not really persuaded. I was, if I was a French citizen and if I had to vote, probably I would have refused, would have abstained. But anyway, in the political forum, we said yes to the constitutional transformation because it's the only way to maintain a level of political union at the European level. You know what is the effect of our decision in that moment, that the National Front in France is now the only political representation of the workers of, for instance, the northern area of France. The National Front has become and is the force that politically represents the workers' refusal of the financial blackmail, of the financial plundering. That is the reason why the National Front is going to be, is already the first party in France, and is going to be the party that will contend the presidency of the Republic to what? What will happen next year at the election for the presidency in France? Well, you will have two parties fighting for the presidency. One party is Marine Le Pen, the National Front. The other party is Sarkozy, or in the best of the hypotheses, Alain Juppé. I mean, the fascist nationalist right against the fascist neoliberal right of Sarkozy. This is the scenario in France at this moment. As for François Hollande, is quote is how do you say is predicted to have around 17-18% of the votes. The left has disappeared in Europe. This is the other important thing that we have to understand. And in a sense, it has disappeared not only because of our decision in 2005 to vote for the union against the workers. That has been an horrible mistake, but because this has been the general line, the general choice, the general political choice of the left during the last 15 years. What is the effect of the financial devastation of the union? It's easy to understand if you have a look at the figures. The Italian industrial product is the industrial apparatus, the industrial infrastructure has gone down, has decreased of 22% in the last 15 years. The Spanish is down of 24%. The Greek, I don't know. If you go to Athens, you can perceive, walking in the streets, what has been the effect of the financial devastation. The effect is that suicide is skyrocketing among young people, that heroin is everywhere in the center of the city, then every month more and more locals and shops and business are closing in the cities, and the sense of humiliation is leading the Greek people to refuse any kind of political demonstration, except at the extreme right and at the extreme left, where some explosion happen time by time. Unemployment is rising everywhere. And do not trust in the voices that say, oh yes, but in the last 6 months in Italy, unemployment is going down. No, it's not true. It's what is true is that the regular jobs have gone down in the last year. The new regular jobs have gone down of 36%, while the precarious jobs, no, pardon me, of 34%, while the precarious jobs have gone up of 36%. So 36% more precarious workers, 34% less regular workers. That means that, yes, unemployment is going down, but precarization is taking the upper hand everywhere. That is the effect of the financial aggression against the society. In the year 2009-2011, in many European countries, like in the United States, like in many parts of the world, we had a sort of general uprising against the financial aggression. The effects of this uprising have been very, 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 very weak, actually, nothing. And this is the point. The political action is unable to transform anything at the level of finance. And democracy is totally ineffective at this level. The Greek example is crystal clear, but not only that. Why so? I would say that we are facing a new situation in which the reality, the concrete reality of life, of political engagement, of democracy, is unable to grasp the abstract sphere of governance, of the financial governance. The word governance is crucial at this level. What is the governance? Why we are using more and more the word governance, and we are more and more forgetting about the word government? Because government means the political will able to transform, to decide, to control reality. Governance has a totally different meaning, which is scarcely analyzed at the philosophical level. But if you read Niklas Luhmann, you understand. Niklas Luhmann explained that at a certain level of complexity, human will becomes unable to understand and to decide. So what can we do? We have to transfer the power of decision from democracy, from the political will, to the techno-linguistic automatisms that are constituting the financial machine. Mario Draghi, which is a smart guy and an ironic guy, after the Italian election of 3 years ago, while politicians and journalists were kind of excited because something is happening. Movimento 5 Stelle, the anti-European, the anti-financial are taking too many votes. And Mario Draghi at a press conference said, "Don't worry, guys. The European economy is governed by the autopilot. The concept of autopilot is the concept that explains what has been happening in the last 10, 15 years in Europe. But you know what? The autopilot is perfect when it comes to decide about the relation between finance and real economy. The real economy is totally submitted by the financial autopilot. The real economy is destroyed, displaced, dislocated, dismantled, restructured according to the financial autopilot. But something is happening at another level, which is the level of I would say of the social unconscious, a level which is not translated in a democratic way, in a rational way, in a political way, but is translated in the form of hate, rage. You know what I'm talking about. I mean, in the United States, we have the most impressive example of the social unconscious reacting against the black president on one side and the intolerable aggressiveness of the financial dictatorship on the other side. Fascism is the word to name what is becoming the majority of the European society. I say nothing about the American, I don't know. But certainly what has happened in the United Kingdom only 4 months ago is the proof of the fact that fascism has taken the upper hand. And when I say fascism is an old word. I know we should create new names, new expressions to define the problem. Probably it's not fascism and it's not Nazism. It's something that I prefer to call not, as Hitler said, national socialism, but more social nationalism. We have to stress the social origin of the new aggressive nationalism that is growing everywhere in Europe, except in Spain. We should understand why. Spain is a country where there is no national government in the last year, but they live very well. I mean, yeah, unemployment is around 43% among young people, but they don't care so much. Spain is the only place in Europe where people are smiling in the streets. I think that Spain is an interesting example of a sort of autonomization of a large part of society from the blackmail of the economy and from the blackmail of the national state. We don't need a national state anymore. That is what you perceive in the street of Barcelona, of Madrid, of Valencia, and so on, where political decision is taken by massive assemblies of people in the municipalities that are led by people like Maria Carmona or Ada Colau, who represent squatters, feminists, indignados, and so on. Will it last? I don't know. Anyway, the general landscape is going towards a sort of general depression of the social life and towards a real dismantlement of the European culture, of the European citizenship, of the European belonging, just to use a bad word. What is left of Europe is the governance of the bank system. But it's not going to work for long, because the right wing, the racists, are going to win almost everywhere, especially in Northern Europe, in Eastern Europe, and so on. So I try to widen my field of attention. I try to to go beyond the limits of the European collapse in order to understand what is happening in the next decade and more. And I think that the problem that we should analyze is the relation between the present crisis and the worldwide economic slump that is underway. I want to say something about this point. Then I come back. I go back to Europe. Some months ago, in the New York Times, I read an article by Clifford Krauss, who says that the flood of raw materials is pressuring prices, prompting a painful shakeout. Oil companies have laid off an estimated 250,000 workers worldwide. Producers, but well, you see, unemployment and price fall and a general overproduction crisis worldwide. The Chinese steel, just to look at steel, Chinese steel is more or less enough for the planet. So Italian steel factories are closing. German steel factories are not closing, but they will. I don't know about the American steel factories, but the problem is that we don't need to produce more steel. Chinese are doing that. And what about corn and oat and wheat and agricultural products in general? Why Bayer and Monsanto have decided this fusion? Well, because the prices of agricultural products have halved during the last 2 years. So we are facing the most huge overproduction crisis of the human history, and we try not to take note of that, except Larry Summers, for instance, who said, reading the Foreign Affairs of March-April, the title was Surviving Low Growth, if I remember well, he speaks of secular stagnation. Deflation, the Japanese situation is becoming the direction of the world. And also, I read an interesting quote for you, taking from the Foreign Affairs once more. I make good lectures and good readings, you know. And Learning to Love Stagnation by Zachary Carabel, who says the McKinsey Global Institute recently estimated that robots could perform as much as 45% of all the tasks currently carried out by human workers, representing as much as $2 trillion worth of annual wages. But by making manufacturing more efficient, technology is also driving down the cost of almost every good in the world, from hamburgers to automobiles. Really? 45% of jobs could be canceled tomorrow morning? Bad news. Bad news. Are you crazy? What are you talking about? This is the point. This is why we have to think with two different brains. We are witnessing, we are facing the most beautiful, the most rich, the most interesting, the most prosperous situation ever. We are facing the possibility of reducing the labor time of the 45%. We are facing the possibility of stopping producing coal, steel, oil, and so on, not because we have become ascetic, how do you say that, ascetic, non-consumers, because we have too much of that shit in our stores. We don't need to work anymore. This is the good news. But we are mistaking this as a frightening, darkening news. That is the point. I think that we should change our epistemological frame in front of the historical process. We should stop thinking about a revolution or reaction, about progress or regression. We should think in terms of gestalt and tangle. The real problem is that our perception of the world, the gestalt that is shaping our vision of things, is totally misleading us. We see fear and misery and unemployment where we should see freedom, emancipation, richness. You know, this is the most interesting situation from the point of view of the possible emancipation of human life from the slavery of the economy that we have ever possibly imagined. But we mistake it because we are unable to come out from the, let's say the word, from the capitalist gestalt. And the capitalist gestalt has become a tangle I think that Gregory Bateson is the philosopher that we should read. Stop reading Marx or Larry Summers, start reading Gregory Bateson, because the real point is there. The real problem is a problem of ecology of mind, is a problem of ecology of perception, is a problem of ecology of projection, of social and political projection of the world. So what's going to happen in Europe next? I think that Europe is seriously out of the picture. I don't even care. 10 years ago, in 2005, I thought with Tony Negri and Danny Cohn-Bendit that we had to save Europe. Now I say, Europe, fuck you. I don't want to think in terms of European Union. It's dead, and we have to start thinking about saving not the institution, not the political form. We have to save the real body of Europe, and the real body of Europe is millions of intellectual workers, is millions of cognitive workers who have not been destroyed, who still are there, still studying engineering and poetry and economy and philosophy and many interesting things. This is the starting point of a possible future. Not probable, I know, but possible. The possibility is there. The possibility still is there in the relation between knowledge, technology, and social potency. Potency, that is the difficult word, because I said probable future. Possible future, what is the possible future? Or better, the possible futures. The possibility is never one. The possibility is always plural. The possible future is in those words of Zachary Carabel, 45% jobs, tomorrow, cancel. This is the possibility, but the possibility has also to be that we do not depend on work in order to live. Salary is the superstition that is obliging us to think in terms of work. Work is no more necessary. Salary is better. Revenue is better. Food and house and love. This is what we need, not salary, not work. You know, I think that we have to go through this night. The night is here already, and we cannot skip it. But we have to go through this night, one, deciding that we want to survive, first of all. So I am not so favorable to the idea of taking part of the coming global civil war. I think that we have to be the minority of people who refuse to be taken into the trap of identity, also of leftist identity. I do not want to restage the anti-fascist war. I want to go away. I want to survive. Second, I think that we have to cultivate the only force that can disentangle the possibility. That only force is us, the cognitive workers of the world. Thank you very much. 45 minutes, 44.
Great, thank you so much, Franco. That was an incredible talk and some really wonderful things for us to discuss. And one of the things that I'd like us to maybe begin with is the hopeful note that you ended on with respect to the cognitive workers in return to what you talk about in Spain about how there are these assemblies these days and wonderful bottom-up forms of decision-making that are happening there. And I'm interested if you, to hear more about why you think maybe that's happening so well and so much in Spain, but perhaps did not happen so much in Greece or elsewhere, and what might be needed to make that more of a phenomenon that happens in many places in Europe.
Well, sometimes historical events are beyond explanation. How do you explain that Spain has been in 1936-39 the place where the coming World War has been, in a sense, anticipated and staged in anticipation? And how do we explain that after some decades of fascism, Spain has come out as the country where the autonomies of the cities have been able to reactivate a form of democracy that is certainly at the highest levels in the world. An interesting thing in Spain is the strength of the local autonomies. The regions, the cities, the city. The city has been a place of survival during the Franco era, and now the city is a place of social autonomy. I mean, how can you explain that 43%, according to the last figures, 43% of people under 35 years are unemployed in Spain? But you know, you don't perceive this. In Italy, everybody is depressed. In France, more than so. In United Kingdom, forget about it, they have always been depressed. And in Spain, you feel the impression that depression is not there. You say, the sun. No, it's not so, because the sun is, we have sun also in Italy. No, I think that the importance of the local autonomy has been the factor of revitalization. Then you have had the acampada. 6 million people in the streets for 1 month. It has been an extraordinary experience of a daily democracy, but also of creation of the social relations, social affection, which explains the creation of Podemos and so on. I am not so triumphalistic about Podemos. I don't think that they will really win or something. The real thing in Spain is the citizen autonomy. That is the point. Mm-hmm.
So along those lines, I'm curious, coming from my perspective in media studies, how you might see new forms of media technologies potentially strengthening these social relationships and affections, potentially harming them. You know, I've been reading some of your recent work this summer about talking about augmented and virtual realities. And I'm just curious to hear about you, given your background within different forms of activist media, what ways you see that potentially functioning these days in the European context.
But, you know, I've been living in the 80s and in the 90s. In the 80s, I was in this country. I spent some years in New York, some years in California, and I was fascinated by the cyber culture. And I went back to Italy in 89, saying to everybody, forget about communism. Internet is the real thing, and it will change everything in the good direction. Wrong. Then I spent, after 2000, 2001, I started understanding that things were not exactly like Timothy Leary promised to me. And I started becoming very, very pessimistic about the effects of media technology. Now I have decided that I am not pessimist, I am not optimist. It's like life. Life is good, life is bad. It depends on the weather, and on, as Deleuze says, it depends very much on the encounters. You have bad encounters and good encounters. So the same is with Facebook. I remember that in 2011, during the days of Tahrir Square in Egypt, every journalist was praising and speaking about the Facebook revolution. Not true at all. Facebook has been very important in Egypt, but an Egyptian friend told me something that is interesting to understand. Many things have happened until January 28. Then, in the night of January 28, Hosni Mubarak decided to shut the electricity and to cut the internet. The morning after, we had the Egyptian revolution. So you see, things are more complicated than good or bad. Anyway, to be more less possibilistic, I would say that in the long run, I think that the anthropological revolution provoked, produced by the virtual technologies, by the online technologies, is an enormous increase of loneliness, an enormous increase in depression. Depression is the Jonathan Franzen is, I think that everybody is reading Jonathan Franzen frantically, because it's the only explanation of the Trump phenomenon. No, it's important. I mean, if you read Freedom, you remember that Barack Obama one day came out from a bookstore with Freedom in his hand. Mm. And I said, oh, banal, stupid guy, Freedom, rhetorical word. Then I read the book, and I understood that Barack Obama is a smart guy. And he was saying something very important. The crucial sentence in that book is the following. People came to this continent, America, because of two things. Money and freedom. But many don't have money. The majority don't have money. So they want more freedom. Freedom of everything, particularly of having a gun and being killed or killed. This is the crucial point in that book. And then I read Purity. And Purity, that is not a beautiful novel, I must say. Freedom is beautiful. Freedom is really beautiful. Purity is more so and so. But the concept is fantastic. Mm-hmm. This idea, oh, I forgot that I'm talking in Boston and Puritanism should not be named, but Purity is all about the destroying effect of the online puritanical culture. Mm-hmm. I mean, the erasure of the body and this kind of overgrowth of a communication, of a sort of language, the bubble mm-hmm. of communication without body.
Right.
This is the depressing effect.
Right. So, sort of to pick up on that point, you talked earlier in your presentation about the techno-linguistic automatons of the financial markets and the ways in which the real economy is subsumed in that. I'm curious to hear when you're talking about the sort of the erasure of the body, if how one the cognitive workers you're speaking of, how one might be able to intervene within these techno-linguistic automatas, if you think there's any possibility of doing that in terms of breaking this subsuming of the real economy to financialization.
Well, first, let's try to understand what a techno-linguistic automatism is. I mean, if you go to the bank in the 50s, mm-hmm. you can talk with the employee, the guy, the teller, and say, no, I will come next month. No, you cannot. Yes, you can. You have a sort of talk with people, and at the end you find a sort of in non-deterministic solution to the problem. Now, if you go and speak with the teller, he rightly says, it's not my fault, my dear. The problem is that if I write X in the machine says, no, it's mm-hmm. not X, it's Z. Right. And I can do nothing against that. This is the techno-linguistic automaton. The progressive transfer of the choice among alternatives from the human society to the machine. The machine is incorporating more and more the decision that we can no more take, but the problem is that we are no more able to take. This is the Luhmann intuition. Luhmann in the 70s, I always remember a talk between Luhmann and Habermas in 1972. I was not there, but I have read about it. And Habermas, the discussion was about information and democracy. And the good social democratic generals, Habermas said, oh, more information, more democracy, no? Obvious. And Luhmann, who was less generous, but probably more smart, said, I'm not sure of that. Because the more information grows, the less people will be able to have the ability to decode the meaning of information. It's a material problem, a problem of dimension, of time. Complexity is a strange word. You don't understand what is complexity if you don't think about the relation between the brain and the informational process. And this relation is in time. In time, you have 0 seconds of time to decide yes or not. The machine in 0 seconds is able to say yes, not. That is the point. This is why we are obliged to transfer our decision to the techno-linguistic automatisms. This is producing an effect of decorporealization of the social relation. Society is becoming less and less a place of decision, more and more a place of passivity and of suffering too. So you ask me, what should we do? And I say, frankly speaking, it's not easy to answer the question, right. But I am sure of one thing, that the problem is eroticism, the erotic relation between human beings. The reactivation of social decision is all about the reactivation of the pleasure of meeting bodies in the streets. That is the possibility. Then what will you do about the machine? This is why I say my answer is about cognitarian self-organization. We cannot imagine that tomorrow we forget about the machines, we go to the teller and we start having long discussions about yes and not. No, no, this is not the point. The machine is there to stay. Mm-hmm. But the problem is, who is programming the machine? Right. That is the point. The machine has been programming according to the interests of financial capitalism. But we have programmed the machine. Cognitive workers have programmed the machine. So the reactivation of the erotic body of cognitive workers is the precondition of a new programmation, of a sabotage and a reprogrammation of the machine itself. That is the way I imagine for a possible future emancipation from the financial dictatorship.
All right. Let's turn it open to questions from the audience.
Well, this seems a little vague about the eroticization of machine programming. People still have to make a living. They still live in the material world. There's still class differences. Technology can be used by ruling interests as much as it can by proletarian or by social interest. We saw that with the comeback of the authoritarian regimes in the Middle East. And we also see that Barack Obama has used technology to create a national security state, which monitors everything you do. So, I mean, it's a utopian vision, but I don't see the material basis for it.
You don't see the material basis. What should we do? One question, sure. One answer. I don't see the material basis too. I mean, if we have a look at the present reality of cognitive workers, because I don't believe anymore in democracy. Can I say that? I like democracy very much, but I do not expect a reactivation of democracy tomorrow. I fear the effects of democracy in the next future, if democracy means the decision of the majority of people. So I say majority the democracy has to wait to come back to the in the next decade. Now the problem is the reactivation of democracy. And the reactivation of democracy goes through a reactivation of the relation between our body and our activity, the activity of programmers, the programmers that we are. I'm not an engineer, but I am a programmer of the machine, cognitive workers, poets and engineers together have created the internet, have created the present online economy. Then the machine has reduced the cognitive workers to what they are now, depressed people. Depressed why? Depressed because of the very condition of their daily life and of their daily activity. I mean, we spend more and more time exchanging information with people that we will never meet. And also, the point is that this is not only a desertification of the bodily life of society. This is also the transformation of social life into permanent war, because precarity, precariousness, is essentially war. When Margaret Thatcher said 40 years ago, there is no such thing as society, there are individuals competing, individuals and enterprise in permanent competition, she declared the global civil war that now is actually exploding. Precarity is the condition of civil war. Precarity means that I am not your friend, I am your competitor, because every day we fight for our salary, for our survival. This is the, so I agree with you. The condition is not a good condition at all. And actually, my first brain tells me no way out. No way out. But I have a second brain. And my second brain tells me that the possibility lies in something like the Spanish acampada, 1 month together in the streets. The reactivation of a possibility which is not political, not essentially political, but erotic, poetical, bodily, the reactivation of the pleasure of life. This is the only way out, in my opinion. Is it difficult? Hyper difficult, but not impossible. That is the point.
Yeah, thank you for a wonderful, very inspiring talk. Totally depressing for almost all of it, and then all of a sudden the sun shines. But so I want to know how we get from the night to the day, and especially in terms of the EU. I completely agree with you on the problems of the EU, on the Eurozone crisis, on what we can call the rise of fascism, certainly a move to the extreme right in many, many countries, the dangers that that suggests. So I want to know how we go from the probable to the possible. And you've been talking in very general terms about we've gone from a complex vision of economics, politics, and society in the probable to a kind of simple, effervescent, wonderful sense of how individuals can speak together, work together, forget about their emails, actually talk to one another on the phone again, because with emails we don't do that anymore. But it's a very much individual, personal view about how individuals come together, become more erotic, and that all sounds wonderful. But I keep trying to figure out how that individual, personalistic, erotic, wonderful kind of life that we're all supposed to get in the future, how we get there from here, from the night. And I begin thinking this is a bit like Marx, who at the end says, basically, we go from this terrible capitalist structure to a time when you're a, I think it's a fisherman in the morning, a hunter in the afternoon, a philosopher in the evening. Okay. In a way, you're giving us that too. So where's this transition? Marx has a revolution, gets rid of the capitalists, but you, I think you said that you rejected revolution. Political revolution, I suppose, because you're anti-politics. So how do we get this major change, maybe revolutionary change, but at a personal level without a major political change?
Well, let's say that the concept of revolution, like the concept of democracy, is misleading because it implies a relation of government, of rational government. When I think, I mean, the word politics too seems to me very weak at the moment. I remember how Machiavelli speaks of politics, and he knows something. I mean, he's the king of this concept. And in the chapter 25 of The Prince, Machiavelli says that the prince, which is the political person, is essentially the male who is able to rein in on the fortuna. Fortuna meaning the chaotic, magmatic complexity of the events. And he also explains that fortuna is a female, and the female has to be beaten and submitted to the will of the prince. A sentence that speaks volumes about the reality of politics, the patriarchal and the violent nature of modern politics, but that is not the problem. The problem is that it's over. It's over because the prince can dominate the fortuna in a condition of low complexity, when the relevant events in the space of information are so few that you can know about them. When the flow of informational events goes beyond a certain level, the human brain, the embodied, affective human brain, becomes unable to deal with the fortuna, and the fortuna takes the upper hand. Unfortunately, the fortuna is not a good guy or a good girl. Fortuna is bad at the moment because it has been informed by the capitalist history, competition, war, and so on, and so on. So the present chaos is not a good chaos, it's a bad chaos. How can we not govern? We cannot govern this reality. I mean, when Barack Obama came to the fore using those three words, yes, we can, I was kind of alarmed. I said, what is he saying, this guy? Is it a banality? Not at all. He never says banality, in my opinion. He knows what he knew. What he was saying. In my opinion, he knew that he was saying something very, 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 very extreme and difficult, because we now know that we can nothing. We cannot even close Guantanamo. Nothing. That is the point. And the present linguistic acts of the President of the United States, in my opinion, should be read as a sort of declaration of impotence. Impotence is the word that explains what is happening now. So I don't think that we can try to govern complexity according to a good project. Impossible. So what should we do? the word autonomy is helping me. We should go away. We should say, okay, is it the war? Go to the war. We go away. We are creating another space of the social imagination, and most of all, another space for the self-organization of those forces, the cognitive forces, the cognitive labor, which is able to deal with complexity, not in the sense of government, but in the sense of actual programming. You know what is the meaning of government? Government means the rational direction of the things, the reduction of complexity to a project. Impossible. But if you take the process from the other end, if you start from the spatial point, I am doing this thing, I am working on the problem of food for a village in a southern Italian region. This is my problem. And as a cognitive worker, as a programmer, as an engineer, as a poet, I am working on that. And the army, I speak of global Silicon Valley. Generally, you know, like Eugenie Morozov says that the Silicon Valley is the hell and the place of the evil. I don't think so. I look at the Silicon Valley like Vladimir Ilyich Lenin in 1917 looked at the Putilov factories. I look at the Silicon Valley like me in the year 68. I was looking at the Fiat Mirafiori, the place of the evil, but also the place where workers were self-organizing or trying to self-organize. The Silicon Valley, the global Silicon Valley, 10 million or maybe 100 million cognitive workers in the world, this is the factory of the present, the Putilov factory of the present, the Fiat Mirafiori of the present. In that place, you will find 10 million people who are suffering, mental suffering, suicide increasing 60% in the last 40 years, in the years of the Thatcher revolution. 60% more suicides in the world. This is the starting point of a transformation, of an affective transformation of the cognitive workers. Cognitive workers are suffering. And the only way out from their mental suffering is self-organization, touching, finding an erotic way to coming out from isolation and depression. You know, once upon a time, we are speaking about psychoanalysis and revolution. Forget about that. Psychoanalysis is no more a special branch that maybe can, like Eric Fromm proposes, to meet the revolutionary process. Forget revolution, forget psychoanalysis. The problem is one. The problem is the only way to come out from the present depression is starting a process of erotic self-organization of the cognitive workers of the world. That is the point. Is it clear? No, it's not clear. I mean, I know that we will deal with this problem for the next 10 years, 20 years, 30 years. And these will be years of war, destruction, and suicide. So I don't have a solution for that. And I don't believe in revolution, because revolution is an act of will. And I don't believe in will. I believe in the unconscious. The unconscious is the point where a new process of self-organization can start. Forgive me.
Thank you. I'm really interested in your mention of survival, avoiding the trap of identity. And if, in fact, it projects that the financial captivism alienates those who, I think you said, the ecology of perception, ecology of projection, those who will be following your lead, yet those that are trapped in the identity with the depression, with the advantages that become fleeting of staying within the capitalist structure and being rewarded for that, but it not being fulfilling. How do we survive, particularly as in a distinction, how do we create what you describe as interacting, as reconnecting, when the process itself divides us further and further, and they are vested in that identity trap, which typically looks at difference and distinction. So if in fact we are divided innately in survival, where do we engage? Do we engage from what is the possible brain? How do you bring those who are trapped within the identity to the side of what you're advocating in a way that's not extremely, extremely dangerous?
Well, thank you for the suggestion. It's more a suggestion than a question. I would say that the brain of probability, the problem of survival is linked with the brain of probability. I mean, inside the sphere of the probable darkness that is coming and is already here, we have to survive. But simultaneously, while surviving, and survival is not a good word. I mean, I have always refused the idea that our goal is surviving. I think that life is more than surviving, but we also have to survive. And inside the sphere of the probable darkness, we have to survive. But the excess is that while we survive, we have to create the conditions for a reactivation of the brain of possibility. And reactivating the brain of possibility, which means the brain of possibility means the ability to imagine a rupture in the entangling gestalt. We have to be able to imagine the good development of, for instance, technology, of robot technology. The majority of the governments of the world, all the governments of the world, are insisting on the problem that we have to fight against unemployment. We have to give job to everybody. Impossible. And actually, unemployment is rising, precarity is rising, and so on and so on. Let's try to, first of all, let's survive. Then let's try to find the possibility of opening the prospect of, just to say something very political and very concrete, reducing the labor time and giving a basic income to everybody. The interesting thing is that somewhere, for instance, in the country of rainy fascism called the United Kingdom, a small part of the political spectrum is starting to think about basic income. Basic income is becoming a sort of realistic world. But I don't think that basic income is like, oh, you are poor, I give you a few money, then tomorrow you will find your job. And no, basic income is something different. Means that the right to life is disconnected from work. Work is not the condition for survival. You survive, then if you want, you work. If you need, you work. But you don't need your work. You need less and less your work. You need more and more your brain. You need more and more the intellectual ability to produce that kind of automation that gives us the possibility of surviving without work or with less and less work. The dialectic of survival and discovery, invention, how can I say? It's not a problem of revolution. It's a problem of invention. Invention is not the good word. When you see something that is there, it's always there, but you have been unable to see it because you are blinded by the gestalt, the form, the shape, the pre-structured shape that is becoming a trap, a tangle. When you at last can see that the possibility is there. How do you call it? I call it invention, maybe, or... this is the problem. Survival and invention. We cannot invent if we don't survive, of course. So, unfortunately, we have to survive. But luckily, we can invent. Thank you.
Any other questions?
I guess it's more an observation, kind of building on top of what you just said about the basic income. May I suggest that the reason why it works out in Spain at the moment is that once you reach a certain threshold of unemployment, where essentially half of people are unemployed, being unemployed becomes normal. It basically is seen, you can no longer say these 5% are undeserving because half of you are in that, essentially. In that category. So basically, in giving everybody universal income, demanding full automation, essentially, where everybody is unemployed, will paradoxically create social cohesion because everybody is now entitled, shall we call it, for the lack of a better word. And so does that mean that what you're proposing is that we should all demand full automation and go for this 45% of jobs being gone, essentially?
In the 70s and in the 80s, I was living in a house, a wide flat, beautiful, in the center of Bologna, which is a beautiful city, in a building of the 15th century, you can guess. But it was so wide that we can stay there in 7, 8, 9 people, more or less. And we don't dislike each other. We had good relationship there, also very good relationship sometimes. And it was a good solution, that you know the effect of it was that I was not working many times and my friend was working and he could pay the rent for me and we could share the rent. I paid for a beautiful apartment in the center of a beautiful city. I paid something like, I don't know, a very small amount of money. You see, liking the surrounding people gives you the possibility of what is rhetorically called solidarity. Solidarity is a little bit rhetorical, but empathy or pleasure is less rhetorical. And pleasure of the relation with the others is the basic condition for what I call autonomy. Autonomy means exactly this. And when we speak of basic income is not only the possibility of receiving 1,000 euros every month, is also the possibility of sharing consumption, of sharing things, of sharing food. If 10 people share their food, they don't pay 1 + 1 + 1 + 1. It's widely known that sharing things means spending less money and so on and so on. This is the basic of social solidarity. The problem is that this has become very difficult because I still live in the city of Bologna, which still is a beautiful city and still is inhabited by students. It's the university place, so like in Boston, you have lots of students everywhere. But now it seems that living together for students has become a sort of torture. They don't like living together, and they sit in the evening at the same table, four people, and each of them is Facebooking with who knows whom, probably with the person who is sitting next. So the problem is that conviviality, sharing, has become difficult for many reasons. That belongs more to the field of psychoanalysis than to the field of politics. But anyway, this is the vicious circle that we have to break. But basic income, in my opinion, is essentially the pleasure of sharing. Sharing not in the sense of the sharing economy, sharing in the sense of the pleasure of being together outside of the sphere of the economy. This is, the good news is that somewhere, someone is starting to think that basic income is a realistic thing.
It to the amount. So I think the sort of the danger, I've been following that basic income sort of conversations from various economists and sociologists, and I think a lot of people are proposing basic income in the amount, which essentially amounts to a subsidy to the corporate world in terms of like it's not enough to live on, and even like basic necessities. It's more like some sort of a subsidy, similar, let's say, in Norway, they split the proceeds from the oil fund, right? So I think people like you maybe should lead forward with the idea that we need to make sure that it's definitely the basic income in terms of satisfying the basic human needs, as opposed to just giving out essentially sponsorship to the corporates who continue paying people under living wage.
All right, so I think we'll have to end this really wonderful conversation here, but I know Frank will be around afterwards if you want to come up and speak to him more, and there are books outside as well. So let's thank him for an amazing conversation and discussion.